أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إن الإسلام بدأ غريبا وسيعود غريبا كما بدأ فطوبى للغرباء فقيل ومن هم يا رسول الله قال صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم الذين يصلحون إذا فسد الناس صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم وفرجنا بحقهم وحشرنا معهم. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Our sincere condolences tonight is due to our present Imam, Imam Al-Hujja Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajuh Sharif, to the Lady of the Ladies, Fatimatu Zahra, Sayyidatu Nisa Al-Alameen, on the sad occasion of the demise of the Holy Prophet of Islam, the sad occasion of the demise and the martyrdom anniversary of Imam Hasan Al-Mujtaba Alayhi Salam, as well as the martyrdom anniversary of Imam Ali ibn Musa Ridha alayhi salam. For all these three occasions, we are having the majlis tonight, inshallah, as a dedication, a humble dedication, an expression of our love, affection, and inshallah, respect for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, giving it to our present Imam, Imam Al-Hujja Jalallah Farajuh Sharif. May the Almighty God be pleased with all of us, any of the brothers and sisters who've made any effort in making the majlis here. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with all Muslims, all followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, who are reviving the matters and the affairs of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, talking about the virtues and excellences of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam in such gatherings and such occasions. I wholeheartedly pray that the Almighty God, inshallah, accepts our gathering of tonight from each and every one of us, whoever has done any sort of contribution, little or much, and inshallah, accept it from all of us, from His bounty, as the provision of taqwa. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajjil farajahum. The topic that I have for you tonight is entitled Ghurbatul Islam. Ghurbatul Islam, or desolation of Islam, as I will inshallah explain it. Because it's an occasion for three maqsoom, I thought of making a talk about something that will be related not only, as you will see, to our three Ma'sumeen that we are commemorating their sad occasion tonight, rather to all Ma'sumeen and in fact to the actual Islam as well. Ghurbat is the noun, and the person who is having this status is called ghareeb, or something that is ghareeb. Ghareeb in Arabic language has various meanings, and we'll see which one will be more compatible and fitting with the discussion that we have. One meaning of ghareeb is when we refer to something that is not common, is not usual, an unusual something, bizarre. Like in the science of ilm al-rijal, that we speak about the biography of the narrators, or the about the actual hadith and narration. When a hadith is narrated by a narrator, that only him has narrated it, that was expected to be narrated by more than one person, we say this is hadith ghareeb. That means that's ajeeb, something that is usually unusual and not famous, and we refer to it as ghareeb, similar to ajeeb. Okay, so this is one meaning of it, strange, unusual, and things like that. The second meaning that we have for ghareeb in Arabic is with relation to someone who is not known, someone who is a stranger, someone who is like an outsider. Like when you as a foreigner go to another land that you don't speak the language, you don't know them and they don't know you, like as a traveler, as a tourist, you will be seen, and you see others as, you know, you will be seen as a stranger. People of that local area, that they know almost everybody, they can tell that you are a stranger, you are not here. This is also, this person in Arabic is called ghareeb. The third meaning that we have for ghareeb is when someone is by himself or by herself, that doesn't have many companions, unaccompanied person, and desolate. The desolate is the one that deliberately, or at least he has, or being deliberately abandoned, that others, they don't socialize with him, they don't give him the respect or the position, the status that he or she deserves to have in the community. For example, we have some ahadith that says that the one who is in debt, even in his own town, often among his own relatives, is ghareeb, desolate. Now, the topic that I have for you, inshallah, tonight is about the desolation of Islam in our modern time. Why is it that Islam, by and large, by many outsiders of the domain of Islam, especially by many people living in the West, that they are not familiar with Islam, why is it that it is frowned upon? Why is it that Islam is desolated? And they don't feel comfortable often to get close to Muslims. And what we want to analyze briefly, inshallah, tonight is to see that as a Muslim, is it permissible for me to sort of isolate myself, desolate myself, or not? We'll see tonight that the Prophet of Islam has, in certain circumstances, admired Muslims who are desolating themselves from a certain community that we need to know what type of community are they. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Before we speak about desolation of Islam, I need to tell you that the role models of Islam, in fact, they were desolate, and they were not given the attention, respect, and position that they really deserved by their own very own community. For example, take the example of Imam Ali alayhi salam, that almost for 25 years he was isolated. His right was usurped as the Khalifa, and he was staying at home. Someone like Imam Ali alayhi salam, that some of the Khulafa, they say, if it was not because of Imam Ali, I would have been perished. For more than two decades, he is sitting at home at the best time of his life, that he could imagine how much he could contribute for the progress of the Muslim community. Instead of giving him position to deliver lectures, to educate the community, to lead the community, they isolated him so much so that he was holding shovels and axes and farming, okay? Even when he was having a position that he goes on the stage and says, Saluni qabla an tafqaduni, ask me before you miss me, whatever you want to know, ask me about it. Look at this, some of the silly people in his community, in his crowd, they turn and on, and some of them, they say that, tell me, how many hair do I have in my head? This is top of the mentality of people who knew him. That's why we say that Imam Ali alayhi salam, such a noble personality, in his own time, among his own people, he was ghareeb. He was desolate and was not given the position that he deserved to have it. Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, that we are commemorating his martyrdom anniversary tonight, surely among his companions during his imamate also, he was a ghareeb. And why not that some of, as you know the history, some of his very close relatives, so close as a cousin, whom he had appointed as the commander of some parts of his army against Muawiyah, they betrayed him and they left him because of money, such as Abdullah ibn Abbas. Eventually he was poisoned to death by his own wife in his own house, Ja'adah, the daughter of Ash'as, who killed the Imam by poisoning the Imam. So in fact, imagine someone who is really ghareeb in his own home. And we know some people that this is the situation that we want to talk about, is some religious people, some pious and religious people, that within their own family, unfortunately, they feel a bit strange and ghareeb, and they are not given the position that they deserve to have. They don't know how to really relate with others around them, because it seems that they can't click. They don't relate to one another because of different principles and values that they hold. As for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, well-known ghareeb Karbala, that's how he was treated on the plain of Karbala, that in a poem that Imam Ali alayhi salam is talking about, related to Imam Ali, about the tragedy of Karbala, Imam alayhi salam, in reciting, reading the maqtal for his son Imam Hussein alayhi salam in advance, he says, لَسْتُ أَنْسَاهُ بِالطُّفُوفِ غَرِيبًا مُفْرَدًا بَيْنَ سَحْبِهِ بِالْعَرَائِ. I will never forget that scene, that I had a vision about it, about my son who was treated as a ghareeb, being by himself, desolate and unaccompanied, very few companions that he had, and majority on all those Kufans who had invited him, they abandoned him. So because he was abandoned, he was treated as a ghareeb, mufradan bayna sahbihi bil-arai. He was by himself among a few companions that he had. When you study the lifestyle and the biography of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, you see that really all of them, in their time, they've been ghareeb and unknown really. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, the same. Imam Baqir, even Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, that we said he had exceptionally so many students, still the very loyal companions who knew the Imam and knew the status of the Imam were very handful. And that's again one of the reasons that Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, you don't see any uprising from him. To give you an example from Imam Ridha alayhi salam, that again we are commemorating tonight his martyrdom anniversary, there is a hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam that the Imam says that one of my grandchildren will be buried in the plain in the land of Khurasan in a city that is called Tus. And then the Imam says that whoever visits Imam Ridha alayhi salam, arifan bihaqqi, whoever that visit Imam Ridha alayhi salam knowing his status, then the Imam is quoting from the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that the Prophet says, or Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, that on the day of judgment I take his hand and lead him to paradise. Then the Imam was asked that, when ya ibn Rasulullah, when you say arifan bihaqqi, what do you mean by arifan bihaqqi, knowing his status? The Imam says that knowing his status means four characters at least he acknowledged for the Imam, that the Imam enjoys or enjoyed at his time. One, Imamun, that he was a leader divinely appointed.
Second, مفترض الطاعة, that he's it's obligatory to follow him and to obey him. Third is ghareeb, and that's why referred to Imam Ridha alayhi salam as ghareeb al-ghurbah, that he was desolate at his time. And fourth is that he was shaheed, that he didn't have a natural death. He was killed, he was poisoned to death. Even about Imam Ridha alayhi salam, I would humbly say that really when we compare our Imam al-Hujjah jalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, when we compare Imam al-Hujjah in comparison to all previous ma'asumin alayhi salam, definitely we can say that he is really ghareeb ghuraba among all ghuraba of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, who were not given the position that they deserve in their time, who were desolated in their time. Imam al-Hujjah, our present Imam alayhi salam, really this title fits him more than anyone else. It is for that the reason that Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says that people of his time, that happens for us often as well, يَرَوْنَهُ وَلَا يَعْرِفُونَ, they see him but they don't recognize him. So the fact that we don't recognize him, it shows that how غريب Imam Zaman Ajjalallah Farajul Sharif is among us, really living with us, and nobody knows him, nobody recognizes him. Okay? That's the explanation that we have. And especially if you consider Olanian, really, someone who's been living with Muslim community here and there for more than a millennium, and still people, they don't recognize him, they don't give him the position that he deserves to have, and that's why he is in what do you call it, in occultation. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, that was about the ghurbat and desolation of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt al-Musalam and Ma'sumin in general. Because of that, we want to say that even Islam, the dear Islam, the religion that has absolute guidance for mankind, was not treated as it deserved during the time of the Imams, and that's why the representatives, the infallible representatives of the Imam, were not given the position that they deserve to have, and even up until now, is and that is where we want to get to, desolation of Islam and ghurbat al-Islam. When I say that from the beginning, I really mean it, and inshallah I will provide you with the hadith, right from the very beginning of Islam. But you think that after the rise of Islam and during the time of the Prophet of Islam, or after the demise of the Prophet of Islam, Islam was spreading around? Now, in fact, Islam, right after the demise of the Holy Prophet of Islam, again showed its ghurbah, was observed really how desolate it was. And that's why Fatima al-Zahra salamullah alayha, after the demise of her father, after the departure of her father from this world, she kept crying, and one of the poems that is recorded from her, that because of such painful things that she was saying, some people of Medina, they asked Imam Ali alayhi salam, they say that Fatima is crying and is mourning so much that really, if you can arrange another place and isolate her, already she was isolated, and they asked for more isolation. One of the poems that she was painfully crying was, وَبَكَا كَالْإِسْلَامِ إِصَّارَ فِي النَّاسِ غَرِيبًا مِنْ سَائِرِ الْغُرَبَاءِ. That means that Islam cries for you, my dear father, like a person desolate, like a person who is so much by itself, by himself, so lonely, like other lonely people and desolate and unaccompanied people. Not only Islam has been treated غَرِيب, what represents Islam, such as our scripture, Quran, unfortunately among Muslims, at least in our present time, the Quran, the Holy Quran, the scripture of Muslims is ghareeb and desolate. Quran has predicted this when in Surah Furqan, the Prophet of Islam says, Ya Rab, inna qawm ittakhadu hadha al-Qur'ana mahjura. This is what the Prophet of Islam apparently will say on the Day of Judgment, that, oh my Lord, oh God, oh my Cherisher, oh my Provider, inna qawmi, my community, my very community, Muslims, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, so-called followers of Ahlul Bayt, the Shia, اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا. They abandoned the Quran. He is a Muslim, but you ask him to read a page of the Quran, I can't do it. We want to start a program, we are looking for some reciters of the Quran. It's hard to find. Not many volunteers are there, because people either they don't know or they are not comfortable to read it. Okay? Later on, getting more into it, later on practicing, and later on the higher stages of being in touch with the Holy Quran. On the Day of Judgment, the Holy Prophet of Islam is going to complain against us that, Ya Allah, my community, us who are relating ourselves to the Prophet of Islam, they abandoned the Quran. How often they were in touch with the Quran in their day-to-day life. Again, we have some ahadith that three beings on the Day of Judgment are going to complain to God about Muslims. One is a masjid in a community that members of that community, they don't attend it, they don't pray there, they don't have time to go to the masjid, but they have time to go everywhere else. Okay, on the Day of Judgment, this masjid, this local masjid of yours is going to complain. This Islamic center of yours is going to complain that they didn't attend me. The second, alimun bayna juhal, if he's a scholar among some people that they don't know their religion and they don't attend his lectures, they don't attend his programs, they don't approach him to ask to learn about their religion. On the Day of Judgment, this scholar is going to complain and say, Ya Allah, I was there, people did not benefit from me, they did not come to learn from me. And the third is, if there is a Quran, a copy of the Quran at home that is there, never opens up, it's dusted. Unless, yes, some people, we only open it for blessing or to protect the house against the thieves. That's all about it. As if Quran is revealed to the Holy Prophet of Islam, Muslims throughout the years, throughout the centuries, more than a millennium, blood of Muslims were given to preserve, protect this Quran so that I can open it in my room, in my bedroom, to protect the house against the thieves. That's all about it. More than that, I'm not expected to know about it. Or only when I need to call a sheikh to do istikhara for me. Other than that, what do I need the Quran for? This whole copy of the Quran on the Day of Judgment is going to be to complain because it was treated again as a ghareeb, desolate. Alright? Even in the whole world today, there is one country that is expecting, claiming, wants to be independent. And because absolute majority of its citizens are Muslims, wants to run the country based on the Islamic constitution, based on the Islamic teachings. There has been an election in a very modern style of it, and people have voted for an Islamic state, and hence it's called an Islamic Republic of Iran. All right? Again, they want to isolate this Islamic Republic. Why? Because it has a stand against a terrorist state. So terrorism, you see that when it comes, an assassination is justified if it is against Muslim scientists. Harboring terrorists is justified and is okay if the terrorists are attacking Muslim officials. But if they are attacking other than them, then we are against terrorism and we are against harboring terrorism. Such an irony, such a hypocrisy again. Again, as you can see, not only Islam is treated ghareeb, not only the imams, the holy imams of Islam were treated as ghurbah, the scripture of Muslims, by even Muslims, by us ourselves, has been treated as ghareeb. And even if anyone wants in today's world really stand on their own feet independently, that practice, they just want to practice their religion and hold their own values, then they will be isolated, they will be boycotted, and so forth. And that's why Imam Baqir alayhi salam says that time will come that when Imam Mahdi ajjalallahu farajahu sharif will come, he will come as if with a new religion, bi amrin jadid. When the Imam says that Imam al-Mahdi ajjalallahu farajahu sharif comes with something new, he doesn't mean that astaghfirullah, he brings a new religion other than Islam. No, that means that Islam and the true and pure teachings of Islam so much have been abandoned by Muslims themselves, by so-called Muslims themselves, and has been so much desolated that when Imam Mahdi comes and brings the pure and original teachings of Islam, even Muslims, they turn and ask themselves, what religion is this? This is the ghurbatul Islam. Okay? And inshallah, I will provide it with a hadith and I'll tell you that what is the solution? What are we supposed to do then so that we bring Islam out of that ghurba? And how can we do that? That Islam, or is it really a virtue to be ghareeb in that sense, or it's not an issue? Inshallah, if you help me with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, I will share it with you. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, first of all, before I share with you the actual hadith that I started my speech with you tonight, let me give you the reference to that. Solution. We are looking for a solution to bring Islam at least within our community out of ghurba, out of desolation. The ayah is in Surah Al-Tahrim, and inshallah I will recite it and you recite with me. Please make sure that you recite with me to bless your mouth and bless our gathering. Ready? A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة عليها ملائكة غلاظ شداد لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Quick translation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us to ward off, to protect ourselves against a fire. There's a fire out there in today's world that is going to burn you, burn your family members, burn your children, burn your faith if you don't ward off against it. Oh, you who believe, ward off first yourselves, talking to us men, first ward off yourself, first make sure you practice your religion in as much as possible to you, and then ward off and protect your family members. If I don't practice, I can't expect them to practice it. Then ward off and protect your family members against what? Against a fire, fire of hell. That fire has fuels, variety of fuels. وَقُودُهَا النَّاسِ. The fuel of that fire are certain humans, so-called humans, devils, with all devilish plots, programming that they have. So well designed. وَقُودُهَا النَّاسِ وَالْحِجَارَةِ. Stones is what they have created, what they have manufactured. Every now and then new manufacturing is coming to pull us into that fire. وَقُودُهَا النَّاسِ وَالْحِجَارَةِ عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I warned you that those who are in charge of that hellfire, our angels, so stern and severe, you cannot afford the consequences of the punishment or what you are doing that has the punishment in the hellfire. Those angels, لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم. They don't disobey God for what He had commanded them. ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. They only do what they're commanded to do. So the solution is, my dear friend, if I want to bring Islam out of isolation within my household so that I can ward off myself against the hellfire, I need to do this. Ward off yourself. Ward off and protect your family members against the fire. Don't treat Islam as something that is ghareeb. In order for you and I to do that, we need to unaccompany ourselves with certain people that are wrong people and make more association and more companionship with people that they are going to bring us closer to God, closer to Islam, closer to our principles and Islamic values. And here is what the Prophet says, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ بَدَأَ غَرِيبًا. Surely, verily, truly, Islam began desolate. That means that right in the beginning, it was only the Holy Prophet of Islam, Imam Ali alayhi salam, and Khadija salamullah alayha, three people only praying on earth. So began desolate. The rest of the Meccans and people of Mecca, not only they were not Muslims, they were against them. So began ghareeb. وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا. The Prophet of Islam foretold that, and time will come that it will return to desolation as it was, as it began in the beginning, as it is today, that you feel sometimes desolated within your family members, within your peers, within your colleagues, and so forth, just because you are Muslim. So much so that sometimes people, they don't feel comfortable to say that my name is Ali Muhammad, and you see they are trying to change the names. Okay? The Prophet had already foretold that then, that's the point. Then the Prophet says that, فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. Good news. Tuba is the name of a tree in paradise. It's an expression for a good position, a very pleasant position in paradise with all kinds of happiness. That the Prophet says that that position is for ghuraba, for the desolate people. That desolation in this sense is a virtue. Desolation in this sense is a virtue. Why? Because when the Prophet was asked, وَمَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Who are they, O Messenger of God? This ghuraba that you are talking about, the form of ghareeb, who are they that you say good position, paradise will be for them? Look at the answer of the Prophet. The Prophet says, and please memorize this part of the hadith. The Prophet says, الَّذِينَ يَسْلُحُونَ إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسِ. People who are desolate, these people who are dissociating themselves, people who are abandoned by a community, but what community? A vicious community. Who? Vicious peers, sinful, criminals, you know, these type of people are abandoning you, it's a virtue for you. It's good for you. The Prophet has promised that Tuba will be for you. If you are dissociated, if you are desolate, desolate from a community who is corrupt. If among the corrupted people you are not treated as part of them, in fact, it's a virtue for you. I'll give you some examples. Imagine, at a school, for the children, for the youth, it's a muck-up day. Kids go and play, do silly things, running around, and eventually they end up meeting at the beach. Is it a day for me to go to school? It's not a school day for you. If you want to have that tuba lahum that the Prophet had promised, a very pleasant position in paradise. Why not? Because the purpose of going to school is to educate myself. This is not an educational day for me. It's a sinful day for me. No matter how much pressure I get from my peers to come, you are not going. The fact that you are not going, you are a desolate. And this is the ghareeb that the Prophet has admired and praised. Another example, at work. It's so common at lunchtime, you see that everybody comes down from the office, goes to a corner shop and getting a sandwich. What about you? If you want to blend in, to be part of them, you also follow them. If you want to be ghareeb and get the promise of the Prophet, Tuba lahum, you have your own sandwich, you have your own halal meal with you, you're going to have it. You don't have to mix with them. Now, do you feel ashamed and embarrassed of doing this? No, because I remember, I feel sorry for them. In fact, one of the girls, she was saying that, I feel sorry for them, that they don't know what I know. And that's why I'm proud of myself as a Muslim and observing hijab and, you know, maintaining my religion, because I know that the Prophet had promised me, Tuba lahum, good and pleasant position in paradise will be for them. No matter how much I will be put under what they call it office tradition, it's an office tradition to go out, Christmas time, Christmas party, everybody goes out and they are going to have an alcohol and a toast. Not you and I, it's not for us. If you are being abandoned, it's a virtue for you. Desolation in this sense is a virtue for you. There's nothing to be ashamed or what do you call it, upset about it. So, to be a good Muslim and ward off ourselves against the hellfire, we need to sort of have a chosen desolation, a chosen dissociation. This is a virtue, and this is how we can really protect ourselves. Don't think that we should always assimilate, associate, or integrate with others. Integration is not permissible with the wrong people. The Prophet says, "Alladhina yasluhun idha fasada an-nas." In a corrupted community, within corrupted peers and colleagues, you are not supposed to associate with them. To dissociate yourself from them, in fact, this is a virtue for you, and a heavenly promise is given. What do you call it for you? One example. At the time of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, there was a narrator. His name is Abu Ubaidah al-Hadda. His profession was, he was a shoemaker. His name is Abu Ubaidah. In fact, about his actual name, there's a discussion. Put that one aside. Apparently, he died in a community that they were not Shia around. He was a very decent, very pious person, but there were not Shia people around that area. And he was not treated as he was supposed to be treated. After his death, his wife cries and goes to Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, and she says that, "I really cried because my husband died as a ghareeb, desolate. And even people did not pray on him. They just buried him because it's a corpse of a human body there." The Imam, look at the answer that the Imam gives. Alright? The Imam says, "Laysa huwa bighareeb. Inna Aba Ubaidah minna Ahlul Bayt." Don't worry about where he was living, whether he was treated by his contemporaries, how he deserved to be treated or not. Because he's one of us, Ahlul Bayt, he's no longer ghareeb in a negative sense of it. And even the Imam goes to his graveyard and prays for him. And what do you call it? As part of the praying, the Imam says, "Allahumma, Allahu Akbar." Look at the dua. "Allahumma nawwir qabra wa alhiqhu bi nabiyyi." Oh Allah, enlighten his grave and join him to his messenger. Another hadith, and inshallah we are done for tonight. In fact, I had a very long day, a little bit more than a little bit tired. This hadith, Shaykh al-Tusi rahmatullah alayhi has narrated in his book Al-Amali. Very brilliant hadith for those residing in the West as a minority, so that they know that they are not minority in the real sense of it. The hadith is from Hamad al-Samandi, and he was Samandari. He was a businessman traveling to non-Islamic territories, lands, countries. He goes once to Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, and he says, "I ask Imam Sadiq alayhi salam that my business is that time to time I travel to Bilad al-Shirk, to non-Muslim countries. And some of my friends are blaming me for that, and they say that, 'What are you doing, Ya Hamad? If you go there and happens that you die there, you've died in a land of shirk. Maybe there's not even a Muslim cemetery to bury you there. Why do you go there?'" Imam asks him a question. Look at the question. The Imam says that, "Ya Hamad, إذا كنت ثم تذكر أمرنا وتدعو إلي." When you are there, nights, weeks that you are there, months that you are there, do you remember us? And do you mention our virtues, excellencies, our teachings with others in that area? He says, "Na'am, yes, I do so." The Imam says, "But when you are in so-called Muslim countries, fi hadhihi al-mudun, mudun al-Islam, tadhkur amrana wa tad'u ilay." In so-called Muslim countries, can you talk about the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam? He says, "No, in fact, there is no freedom to mention that." Then the Imam says, look at the hadith. The Imam says, "Innaka in tamud thamma tuhshar ummatan wahdak wa yas'a nuruk bayna yadayk." The Imam says that, "Don't worry. Keep doing your business going there. If it so happens that you die there, you will be resurrected
as a Muslim community, not as an individual, as a Muslim community. And your nur, your light, will run forward you on the day of judgment. Why? Because you were a very practicing Muslim. Not only that, a practicing Muslim who shares Islam and shares the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam with non-Muslims. May the Almighty God bless us, help us, and inspire us to be able to maintain our religion and inshallah share it with those who don't know. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Ya Allah, what a night is tonight. Usually because we are holding one majlis commemorating three great and sad occasions, it's a little bit difficult which majlis to lead. But the truth is that tonight the host of the majlis is Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Ta'ala Farajul Sharif, as I said. The host of the majlis, the one who cries from the lady's side, is Fatima al-Zahra Salamullah Alayha. Brothers and sisters, let's turn off the lights to open inshallah and to turn on the lights of our hearts and see where should we go tonight really. Do we go to Mashhad of Imam Ridha alayhi salam, paying respect to the holy shrine of Imam Ali ibn Musa Ridha, ghareeb ghurbah? Or do we go to Medina, where the holy shrine of the holy prophet of Islam is? Or do we go and cross the road and go to Jannatul Baqi', where the grave of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam is? Dukhtare bint ad-duja imsha سجادارد عزایا گه پدر گاهی حسن گاهی رضا. The only daughter of the Prophet of Islam is mourning three times tonight. Often she says, "Dad, my father, or my son, or my grandson, Ali ibn Musa Ridha." Not only the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam were ghuraba, brothers and sisters, even the Holy Prophet of Islam was ghareeb. Even at his time towards the end of his life, the Messenger of Mercy was still alive. Yet they accused him, one of the so-called companions, a hypocrite, accused the Prophet of Islam that innahu la yahjuru, he is in delirium, he doesn't realize what he is talking about. I wonder how the Prophet of Mercy felt when he hears that. Even soon after his departure from this world, instead of attending the holy funeral of the holiest man on earth, the last messenger of Islam, they got together under a shed called Saqifa Bani Sa'idin, making a plot. So even the Prophet of Islam, for his funeral, he was ghareeb. And he was dissolute and was abandoned. Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, not only nowadays that he doesn't have any visitors in Baqi, Mawali Ahl al-Bayt, brothers and sisters who here in this part of the world got together in respect of Imam Hasan, بعد منزل نبود در سفر روحانی. Send your hearts to Medina.
pay a visit to the lonely grave of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. Because even the Imam in his own house, he was treated as a person who is dissolute. As I said, he was assassinated to death by his own wife, Ja'da al-La'ina. Not only that, even when the funeral was in process and they wanted to carry the body of the Imam, the holy of the body of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, for the final farewell with his grandfather, the holy messenger of Islam, they refused to allow that to happen. Not only that, even they targeted the holy body of the Imam. An arrow sat on the shroud of the body that Imam Hussein had to pull them out from the dead body of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. And Imam Ridha, let's go to Mashhad now, ghareeb ghurbah. That before Imam Ridha alayhi salam departs Medina for good, he asks his children, his child, his son, his family members, all to get together in his house. And he mourned and he asked them to cry for him. One of them turns around and says, Ya Rasulallah, you are on the way for a trip. It's not good to moan and cry for you. Why do you want us to cry? The Imam says, because I know that I will never come back to this city again. And I know that where I'm going to die, I will be by myself. No one will be, none of my family members will be with me. But لا يومك يومك يا أبا عبد الله. May I be sacrificed. وعظم الله أجرك يا صاحب الزمان. None of them were treated as Imam Hussein alayhi salam was treated. The desolation of Imam Hussein alayhi salam was beyond the depth, beyond imagination. Because the body of the Imam was left by itself. A body that was looted. A body that was chopped into pieces. A body that was crushed under the feet of the horses, and 3 days and nights on the plain of Karbala. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin wa say'alamu al-lazina zalamu ayyamun ghalabin yan ghalabun.